Here's our top 10 list tonight. The category, here it is, right here. It's top 10 lies we tell our guests. This is a rare behind-the-scenes glimpse here. Top 10 lies we tell our guests. Number 10. Don't worry, there are still lots of people watching at 1:25 a.m. Number 9. Those are clean towels. Number 8. Sure, Dave would love to sing a duet with you. Number 7. We invited you here because we've wanted to have you on for a long time, and not at all because our other guests canceled, and we're really desperate, Regis.
Joke.
It's simply... Number 6, relax, he's not the same guy who does Dave's hair. Number 5, we brought you here on a bus so you'd have more funny stories to tell. Number 4, Dave saw your movie and loved it. Number 3, Dave saw your movie. Number 2, we'll edit that out later. Number 1, they're not booing, they're chanting Dave. You look like a hitter. What are you dressed like that for? You look
Me?
Like a greeter at a bad casino.
No.
Mr. Philbin a tie, please. Something
Anytime
nice.
Gary Vale is in the audience, I dress like this.
Nice to see you.
No, me, Dustin Hoffman, and Tom Cruise like this all the
really?
Time.
Really? Yeah. But I see you on your program in the morning.
Yeah.
By the way, it's a great show. And I just want to say something. I think you're terrific at what you do.
Really?
You're just the best.
Well, thank you, David.
Let's spend a minute here and do a little history on you. When did you first start doing a television show? You were just a kid, I'm guessing, when you started, huh? Right out
the
of college?
No.
How old a guy were you when you started?
How old a guy was I? I was in my late 20s.
Late 20s. This was in California someplace?
Yeah, California. Okay. San Diego, California.
San Diego. What kind of show was it?
Well, I started out as a newscaster.
Right.
And then got a talk show late
Did you
night.
Want to be a newscaster?
No, I wanted to be a talk show host.
Yeah.
And then came the talk show. Mm-hmm. And that was in the 60s, and here we are.
No, you left out a big hunk. I mean, you've been doing
What did
this...
I leave out?
Well, you said the late 60s, and then here we are. It's the late 80s.
Yeah.
Come on.
In other words, you want the whole biography.
Well, I would just like to know, because I really admire your success.
Do you have a one-bedroom place, or is it just a one-room?
Now it's just wide open space. Here, slip into that.
You really? Mind?
Yeah, that looks
you
much better.
No, I don't think so.
That doesn't have tourist written all over it, does it?
No,
need a ride
that.
Into town, buddy?
Not anymore. Is it a one room or is it a one bedroom?
Well, I don't know. I haven't been down there. I've not been allowed on the site. Problem with some kind of radon.
Isn't it the
something.
Worst when you start that remodeling?
Well, you know, I knew it was going to be tough, and I said, don't give me a date, because then if you don't come in at that date, I'll start to go insane. And then today, they called up with something that was, you know, I expected at least in the same calendar year.
it's such not. Aggravation, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's not that I guess the planetarium is the problem.
Planetarium?
But, anyway, now tell me more about your shows and then work right up to the present.
Oh, my gosh, David. Well, I had a late-night show in San Diego, California.
Right.
Channel 10.
I
did it for 3 years, and 3 years to the day that I started that show, Westinghouse pulled me out, and I followed Steve Allen in the Westinghouse lineup.
Right.
And I did that for about 6 months, and the show went off the air. Merv Griffin followed me. Today, Merv Griffin is a multi-billionaire, and I'm wearing this tie.
Wearing handout ties, yeah. Right. But you're a veteran of broadcasting and...
You know, I hate to hear that, because it makes me feel old.
No. I admire anybody who can sustain and persevere and succeed in television. I think it's to your credit.
Well, I guess I've been around a while.
Yeah, now tell me about the program you're doing now. It's syndicated all over the country.
You mean the one with Kathy Lee and me?
Vicki Lee and...
David, please. You know that I had to ask her permission to come on the show tonight. I had to ask her permission because of all the fun you and Paul have had with her.
She's a very nice woman. I don't...
And you know her name is Kathy Lee. You're just having fun when you say...
Vicki Lee.
Right.
Crosby.
Oh.
Right?
Oh, she's going to kill me.
No, I know. I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. She's a lovely woman, and if you've not seen the show, she's terrific.
You like her.
She's married to a legendary sports figure in New York, Phil Rizzuto.
Oh! Now we're in trouble. Now we're in a lot of
but
trouble.
But the two of you have a big, like, nightclub act.
We do, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, tell me about the act. What do you do? Who comes out first?
Well,
you or Vicki?
I'm sorry, Kathy. I've got no control over him. We come out together.
Yeah.
And we sing and we cavort and we dance.
Oh, now, wait a minute. Let's go to the cavorting.
Cavorting's fun.
What, do they have to turn a hose on you?
Well, after we cavort, it helps. But, no, we have a, we do a little bit together, and we sing a song together.
Do you work big places or dumps?
Just Trump Plaza, that's all, in Trump, Atlantic City.
Trump Plaza, mm-hmm. Wow. And how many does that seat?
About 750.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a big room.
Yeah, well, yeah. That's good.
We filled it up last weekend.
Yeah. And you do like an hour, hour and a half?
An hour and a half, sure. Yeah.
And you sing?
And then Kathy does her act, mm-hmm. and then I come out, I do my act, and then we close together.
Mm-hmm. A lot of patter?
Yes, absolutely.
Give me an example of the patter.
Isn't he murder? He's absolutely murder.
Oh, come on.
You mean the patter between us?
No, when you talk to the audience, you know? Yeah, you must have an opening joke, right? You must open with a gag.
No, everything's spontaneous.
Well, give me a spontaneous joke you've been doing for a few years.
Spontaneous joke.
I'll let you think about it. We got to do a commercial. We'll be back here with Regis Philbin. Right.
Incidentally, this is the smart way to dress these days. This is 1989. You know?
Yeah, that. I know. Really, but it's only that I've never seen you like that. Usually on your program, you're always very nicely dressed.
Well, I'm sorry. I just didn't wear. This is how I dress late night, that's all.
No, how you dress if you're working with the power tools downstairs and you're late to come over to do the show.
Well, I was called. Who dropped out, really? Why am I here?
No, we've been trying to make this booking for a long time.
Oh, come on.
Tell me about working as a page in this place.
You know, I worked here as a page in the late 50s.
Now, that's when the page corps really was something,
and
wasn't
it? And they wore braid, and they wore epaulettes, right. And they really...
Did they have inspections and stuff?
Absolutely. Yep. A guy came out and inspected you every night before you took the floor. Yeah. I used to work downstairs. I worked on this floor, and I worked downstairs, too, in a little cage. And people would come up and ask for directions, you know, and what was playing around
the building
town.
In those days was alive with production?
Alive with production. Yeah. Philco Playhouse, Robert Montgomery Presents, all those great shows we hear. And it always brings back a lot of memories. Yeah. So I'm down there one night and giving out directions, you know, and you had your own little show in the cage.
Sure.
Guy came up to me, he said, and whatever he asked me, and I gave him a real snappy answer. The guy said, "You're one of the sharpest. You're one of the brightest young guys I've ever seen in my life." He said, "If you're ever looking for a job, give me a call." Yeah. And he gave me a little card face down. Now, that was your big hope as a page, to get out of the cage, to mm-hmm. get out of the page boy uniform and become a part of this business.
It was a stepping stone to something bigger
in
show business.
And I thought for sure this guy was a Broadway producer. Mm-hmm. Instead, he owned Ray's Drugstore in Brooklyn. And wanted me to have a job there, yeah. But you know, I also was offered a job as a stagehand. I'm trying to get rid of that tie. He keeps bringing it back.
Just dropped it over here.
Yeah. Do you want to hear the story?
I know. I'm listening. Go ahead, Regis.
I know when he gets bored.
No, come on. Just tell the story.
So the guy calls me from Hollywood, California, KCOP, Al Flanagan.
Channel 13.
That's right. Yeah. He said, "I got a job here for you as a stagehand." So all of a sudden, here I am as a page in New York versus a stagehand's job in Hollywood. I was, you know how you are when you're young. Are you making the right decision? I was making myself crazy. I would stop people out here on 50th Street saying, "Look, you don't know me and I don't know you, but I'm a page here at NBC. Should I go to Hollywood and become a stagehand?" People were calling the cops. They were just crazy. Finally,
you're still like that, aren't you?
A little bit.
Yeah.
Finally, I went to the Gypsy Fortune Teller at 42nd Street and Fifth Avenue.
Really?
Absolutely. Went upstairs for a buck. For a dollar, you could either have your cards read or your tea leaves read.
Oh.
She said, "What'll it be, kid?" I said, read the cards. Uh-huh. Threw a buck down. She turned over the Queen of Diamonds and said, "You're taking a trip." Got on the plane, right
that
to
was
Hollywood.
It. No kidding.
Absolutely.
And if she had said, "You're going to hang around the city for a while," what would you have done?
Got on the plane, right to Hollywood.
No.
But that's what I did.
But do you think it would have made... I mean, sooner or later, you were going to get to where you are now, don't you think? I mean...
I guess so, but it just looked like everything was moving out there.
You really wanted to be a singer, first and foremost, right? Is it when you were in college?
When I was a kid, I wanted to be a singer, yeah. I loved all of Bing Crosby's old songs. You know, it's funny. My parents always wanted to know, what did you want to be?
Yeah.
What do you want to be?
Sure.
And I never told them, and I went 4 years to Notre Dame. And when I graduated, the day before I graduated, they came to the campus. And it was during a horrendous rainstorm, and I could tell my mother was angry to begin with, you know, mm-hmm. driving in all that rain from New York.
Who wouldn't be?
Sure. So we walked over to the music hall, and I had a little guy playing the piano there, and I sang Pennies from Heaven to her. Well, they thought it was the end of the world. He had 4 years of college, and he wants to, be, wants to be a singer.
We got to go here? I tell you what, how about a little
Pennies? I'm not finished with
the
song.
Yeah, no, trust me.
You asked for the story.
No, no. Why don't you sing us off a little Pennies from Heaven as we go away?
But anyway, so...
Paul, you got a little...
But my mother said...
Just a little, just like the first... Here we go. Every time it... Go. Take it. Come on.
Every time it rains, it rains.
We just filled us.
Jerry, this is for you.
Each cloud contains the pennies from heaven.
Yeah.
Find your fortune falling all over town.